Circuit 42 would like to thank Pop Culture Paradise, Toy Anxiety, the Spawn Point Gamers Lounge, and Dragon's Lair San Antonio.
This is Duke. Remember, kids, go to circuit42.com and like them on Facebook. Now you know, and knowing is half the battle. Yo, Joe!
This is Ian McIntosh at Circuit 42 in this special episode of Film Circuit Breakdown. I am here with my co-host, Shane Fitzgerald.
Welcome to Circuit 42 Interviews the 80s.
As we are here with a special guest, Mr. Michael Bell.
Hey, guys. Hello, everybody listening in. This is, well, so far it's not fun. It's just the opening. Let's see where we go with it.
So, for those who don't know, who are you and what do you do?
Well, if they don't know, why the hell are they listening? That's what I wonder. If there's anybody listening and I say, Michael Bell, I say, who the hell is Michael Bell? Then hang up, because you better know who I am. Just go to imdb.com, type in Michael Bell, or go to michaelbellvoices.com, and you'll kind of get a general idea. But I guess if you're a latchkey baby, which most of my fans were, then you've watched, let's see, Transformers, G.I. Joe, the Smurfs, the Snorks, Plastic Man, and Johnny Quest, and Thunder the Barbarian, and then those, and then of course the recent babies would be the people that watched Rugrats. And I did voices on all those shows. Those were my shows, and the game shows, of course, not the games, the video games as well, such as Defiance of Kane, Ratchet and Clank, Matrix, etc.
I was actually speaking of video games, one of the big ones I wanted to bring up was Metal Gear Solid 3.
Right.
And there was something that was kind of interesting when I was going back and playing through the Metal Gear games. I noticed that the four major bosses, yourself included, were all played by people who I used to associate with 80s cartoons from my childhood.
Right.
I always wondered if that was intentional.
No, actually, it's not. It's just that we were there and people knew us, so they hired us. You know, they called us in when I read for Fear, and I'd worked for the casting directors before that. A lot of the casting directors for the video games also worked with us when we were doing the animated shows. So they knew that we were capable of whatever it is they needed. So I guess what you do is you reach for who's ever closest to you or you most secure with. It's pretty much standard. But no, it wasn't. Oh, let's use Michael Bell in the voice of Fear because everybody will buy the game because they'll remember him from Transformers as Prowl. That isn't what it was about.
See, the main thing I wanted to ask regarding that, because, you know, kids of the 80s know you mainly as Duke, and a lot of kids in the 90s will know you as Drew Pickles. Now, when you look at your video game work in games like Fatal Frame 2, where you played Sajiro Makabe, and mm-hmm. where you played the Fear in Metal Gear Solid, now, I know, of course, you know, a lot of the people we've had on here will say, oh, you know, it's acting. You know, we just play different characters. But is there any kind of different mindset that you have to have when playing a character like the Fear as opposed to playing a character like Drew Pickles or playing a character like Duke?
You know what you do is you let the dialogue take you where it needs to take you, and you immediately create that character around that. Because you're a voice, you have to. I teach voice animation, so what I teach my students is you have to paint the picture. So if you can do it vocally, then they get the idea. Despite the prototype that they show you, despite the character they show you, I mean, if they show you some guy who's creepy looking, but he's big and he's buff. I mean, how many voices are you going to get for him? Unless, of course, he's a type. If he's a hero, it's probably closer to your voice, maybe a little bit deeper. But if it's someone like Fear, then it might have a bit more gravel to it. And then there's an attitude. And, of course, when it's Drew Pickles, he's a sweet little guy with red hair and glasses and tiny little mustache, and he's Mr. Everyman. And so the voice goes, you know, somewhere in this area over here. He's necessarily not going to sound like Duke, is he?
Sorry, I just completely nostalgic. It's basically nostalgia is an adverb. Sorry about that.
It's nostalgic. Well, listen, nowadays anything's acceptable. People say, whoa, that's, what is it? That's so fun. There's no such thing as that's so fun. That's either so much fun or that's not fun, but so fun, sorry. So you're welcome to your abrogation. It's okay.
So one of the things I wanted to ask, like everybody, you know, especially with the recent G.I. Joe movies, one I didn't feel was that great and one that was a lot of fun. What was it like playing the role of Duke, especially as long as you did in the G.I. Joe cartoons? And what is your opinion of the adaptation that they did in the live-action films?
You know, I'm always asked that question about the adaptation. I've got to be honest, I've never seen them. I haven't seen any of the G.I. Joe on camera because it's not my kind of film, nor have I seen any of the Transformers on camera, the films. It's not my kind of film. It's not the thing that attracts me. And, of course, I have no nostalgic feelings about it because it's not me. It's not anybody I know, particularly that is doing it, so I'm not drawn to it. As far as playing Duke is concerned, it's wonderful because he's he's the great American hero. So here I've been, kid raised in Brooklyn, going to the films and seeing all the films with all the guys that played heroes, like Robert Mitchum and John Hodiak and John Wayne and so many of the others. They all had sort of an attitude, a type, strong and silent and tough. So it was kind of fun to play that. And to even behind the microphone, to stand strong, puff myself up, and dive in. That was always great fun.
So I gotta ask. I know a lot of people. A lot of people probably don't realize how long you've actually been acting since around 1957. And two questions regarding that. How did you first break into acting? And the other big question I wanted to ask was, how has the industry changed as an actor from 1957 to today?
Well, 57 to today, first breaking in. I came from Brooklyn and first started as I worked as an usher at Grauman's Chinese for about a year, then ushered several other theaters, then worked in behind the counter selling popcorn. Went on to eventually move into Hollywood itself, into a little hole in the wall, which is really saying a lot because I don't think it was even that big. Just tooled along, did a lot of theater. I studied acting in New York, and I was at the High School of Performing Arts, so I was prepared to be an actor, not particularly prepared to be an on-camera actor. I did a terrible film called Damaged Goods, which is ghastly, but hey, somebody wanted me for a film, saw myself and said, wow, that career's not going to go anywhere, but I was wrong. Over that period of time, eventually just continuing knocking on doors and finding a small agent, then a bigger agent, then a bigger agent, nobody huge, but another agent, until finally I got to be recognized at the studios and got my first TV thing. I think was it was kind of like live action. So I did a soap opera called Morning Star, and I was a regular on that, and then prior to that, I did a thing called The Verdict Is Yours, which doesn't even exist anymore, and it was a tape show, old improv, which I was geared for, so I got to, got to get going, and then right after I got going, I did a film called War Is Hell. Somebody saw me in a play at a little theater in Hollywood and said, I'm going to put you in a movie, and a year later, he put me in a movie, and then I came out, and I finished the movie, and then I was called into the Army. So I went in the Army and came out and just started to knock around again and try to knock down doors again and just kept pounding and pounding until finally I got a couple of TV shows, and one thing led to another, and I was guest starring on almost all the shows in the 70s and 80s. And then decided I'd like to do voiceovers, to do voice animation. And the girl I was dating at the time and also became a good friend, Jordy Gerber, said, you've got to be doing voiceovers, you really have to do that. So she took me to see Mel Blanc, who I think we all know, Bugs Bunny, Pepe Le Pew, Tweety Bird, whatever. Sensational, brilliant, brilliant, talented man, and I got to watch him work, and I said, I want to do that. That's what I want to do. So I wound up doing it. wound up getting into it. So that's pretty much it. The rest is history, or whatever you want to call it. Now, as far as 57 to now, I'm not sure I'm a good authority in how things are different between now and 57. 57, there were a few people getting into the biz, I guess. You certainly couldn't get, you wouldn't have to worry about stars doing commercial. And we certainly, as we started to do voiceover animation, we didn't worry about celebrities popping us out of our job or bumping us out of our jobs because celebrities weren't interested in doing animation. And that certainly changed in the, I think, possibly 70s. And then that was the beginning of a cutback in a lot of work for a lot of the actors that were doing it on a regular basis. I was fortunate. I had 40 years in it, close to 40 years in it, before I decided this, you know, that's it. It's really good. It's fun. I'll do it when I get called, but I'm not going to kill myself for it.
Yeah. Shane, did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. First of all, Mr. Bell, I just want to say we actually have two things in common. First of all, you said you served in the military, and I'm actually in the Canadian Armed Forces. And
okay.
And that's considered military somewhere, I'm sure.
You Canadian Mounties, that's what I want
to know. No, that's something else. You mentioned before that you actually have some background in improv, and I do a bit of improv myself.
What is a bit of improv? What do you mean a bit of improv? What does that mean? That you do what, a bit of improv?
Oh, I just started out. I'm just starting out in improv now.
Where in Canada?
I've actually done a bit of classes with Rapid Fire Theater in Edmonton.
Edmonton. Okay, good. There's Rapid Fire Theater. I just always like to know where the improv people are. My wife is one of the creators of the Groundlings, one of the founders of the Groundlings here in Hollywood, which is the most extraordinary improv group I've ever known. We're very friendly with all of them. But I trained improv at Performing Arts High School. It was just part of the curriculum. So.
Okay, well, Rapid Fire Theater has a bit of a pedigree now. It was actually... one of the alumni is Nathan Fillion, and someone still active with the company now but is also doing his own thing is Mark Meir, who is the voice of Commander Shepard as well as doing television, and he still does local theater. So as you mentioned, he's very busy as well, as are most actors who do voice acting as well.
Yeah. That's where the time and the energy and I guess even to some degree the money is. It's a little hard. The other end is a little difficult.
Yeah.
But that's good. I'm glad you're doing improv. I think that's. I tell all my students. I said when they say what can we do to really sharpen our skills. I said get into improv. At least get into an acting group, and then if you can get into an improv group, get into an improv group. That's going to help you create characters and find out who you are and what your limits are.
Yeah, it kind of helps sharpen your skills and keeps you spontaneous, is what I found.
Oh, absolutely, it does. Absolutely. My daughter is doing it now. My daughter, Ashley Bell, she starred in The Last Exorcism, the one I think was in 2010, and then the second one recently, The Last Exorcism 2, and then several other films. And she just adores improv. She's at the Groundlings now, as a matter of fact.
Excellent.
So that's it's important. It's very important to keep up on it and keep yourself tuned in.
Yeah, I agree. And I just have to say that looking over your body of work over the years, I have to say I'm very surprised by your range. I mean, you go from doing the All-American Hero Duke in the 80s to doing characters like Raziel in the Soul Reaver series, which is one of my favorite series. Mainly because of Raziel, who's such a unique character, and it just makes me wonder. Like you've done so many roles, are there any roles that like really stick with you and stick in your mind? Like any favorites?
Yeah, probably. I love doing Chaz in Rugrats very much. There was so many levels for Chaz. Chucky's dad. I love doing that. There was a wonderful character in Crazy Claws which I got to play, who was the park ranger. And I got to fashion him after my aunt from Brooklyn. I made him sound like my aunt from Brooklyn. And then, of course, there's the guys in the Smurfs. The Smurfs was great fun. I got to play three different characters in that. And that was always that was a kick. You know, everybody, they were all my children to some degree. You know, Plastic Man's my kid, and Zaymot's my kid, and Major Blood's my kid, and the Snorks, you know, All-Star's my kid. I mean, those are all great fun, but the stuff that really stands out probably are those. And the most stand out for me, the most, was a film I did for Steven Spielberg. It was an animated film, combination of animated film, was A Wish for Wings That Work as Opus. It was Opus, A Wish for Wings That Work. It's a sensational Christmas special. That was really, truly a treat.
I thought I recognized your voice the entire time, and I realized it was Opus.
Yeah, it was for Opus. In fact, remember that Robin Williams was in that, and Dustin Hoffman. Some really good people. I never met them, but I came in and did Opus, and it was just one of those things that turned out so well. I was so pleased to be part of such a great project.
That was one of my favorite Christmas specials, and I was surprised that only in the last few years did I actually get a DVD release.
Yeah, it's sort of like a redheaded stepchild for some reason. I don't know why. It should have been a series. We'd all held our breath hoping it would be a series, and I contacted Berkeley Breathitt, who created it, and we were both talking about it. He said he felt good about it, and then Spielberg decided to go with Family Dog or something that was a dog and really went into the toilet very fast instead of going with Opus.
Yeah, because I remember Family Dog got started on Amazing Stories back in the 80s, and I remember watching the show, and even as a kid, I remember watching Amazing Stories and then watching the show, and even as a kid, I was like, this isn't Family Dog. And I think the fact that they tried to play it so safe.
Yeah, they did. They were very, very safe with it. Yeah. Yeah. And I love the mix in Opus. I love the mix of old movies and him being in an old movie like Shangri-La, which, what great fun. What fun that was to be part of an old film and to be characters in an old film. I mean, I'm sure it took licensing, etc. But, wow, what a great concept to do an animated show where the character gets caught up in things and in stories, and it's a mix with old black and white films. It's, what a kick.
Sorry, two of the things that I personally remember that you did was Little Nemo Adventures in Slumberland and the Pride of the X-Men pilot. And
yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. Listen, you know, you remember better than me. I remember Little Nemo. And I don't remember doing the X-Men pilot, but every now and then when I go to my IMDb, someone says, reminds me of it, and I remember doing the X-Men pilot. It's really funny. And doing, Spider-Man. Doing, Dr. Octo in Spider-Man.
Yeah, Dr. Octopus in the, I think it was the Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so funny. I look at the actors that have done it on camera, and I go, hey, I should ever meet them. I say, you know, I was there before you. I did it first, you know.
There was, in one of the, I know in one of the recent Spider-Man games, they actually, since they had four different versions of Spider-Man, they had four different voice actors who had played him, including the Spider-Man from Amazing Friends.
Oh, who's that now? That's interesting.
I can't remember, but I know they even had Neil Patrick Harris, since he played him in the series that ran briefly on MTV. They even got him in to be one of the voices as well.
Yeah. And it's really interesting. It's interesting. And there you go, with his celebrity status as well. You know, once again, it's not that, you know, Neil's great. He's a talented guy. But it's what we, you know, it's what most of us do in terms of voiceover. It's what we do specifically. So, you know, it was sort of a kick in the kishkas to go, wow, Jesus, you know, I have no choices. And what do? You do whatever you do. But then to suddenly say, well, we're going to use this superstar now, and you go, oh, okay, fine.
I think he was going to say he was kind of an exception, because that was after like Starship Troopers, and like at that point everyone still knew him as Doogie Howser.
But you don't understand. Doogie Howser is important. That's a celebrity status because he did Doogie Howser. That's already a celebrity. That was a huge smash hit, and he was very well known because of that.
That makes sense. I think it was, even though it was on when I was a kid, I never really got to experience much of the show, so it never really dawned on me how much of a hit that show actually was.
Yeah, it was a major hit, and he was a big star. I mean, you know, despite the fact he was still a very, very well-recognized name, so we're just talking about, when you talk about actors that are not recognized names, I'm not going to mention them, but they worked all the time, and they worked all the time in voiceovers, in voice animation. And they were actors. You know, I don't call anybody a voice actor. They're actors. They create a character just as much as those of us that did on camera. But we create a character without the use of makeup. We do it vocally. So that makes it even more interesting in the final analysis. We're not dependent upon any gimmicks. It's us developing that character.
There was actually one thing that I wanted to ask back in regards to Little Nemo. Little Nemo was a Japanese co-production, and I always, like, with a lot of Japanese animation, of course, the animation is done first and then the voice acting. Now, with Little Nemo, was it done that way, or was it done in the, you know, in the way that we generally know here in the States?
I don't even remember. I don't remember. The only thing I remember was doing a two film, remember, Pippi Longstocking and Voltron, Defender of the Universe. Those are the only two I remember doing two film. Oh, well, we didn't Voltron the film. I mean, basically, you know, both the film was already made. What we did in Voltron is they just had us go into the studio and say, okay, you've got 30 seconds for this line. You've got 20.2 seconds. You have one half of a second to do this line. And we would do them without knowing what we were doing and what the story was about or anything. Some of them, I guess, maybe Little Nemo, possibly, I don't recall.
It is interesting, though, looking at your work in Voltron as actually a couple of characters. You were Lance, Craig, Shannon, Willow. You were a couple of different characters in the show. And it's just interesting looking at Voltron and looking at the work you did. And that and Robotech really were the beginning of Japanese animation really hitting big here in the United States. In a lot of ways, and just how much that's changed. I mean,
Maybe. I don't know.
Sorry.
Good.
I was just going to ask, like, you know, looking at animation as a field, and looking at, you know, the anime as it's come over to the States now, and looking at it then. What are your feelings being a part of that? Because you really are a part of it, in my opinion.
Well, I don't, you know, I don't do anime now. I don't do much of that now. Now, of course, I'm with my reoccurring character on Rescue Bots, we do what we always do. What's nice about that is we all do it together. We're all behind the mic, and we all can act and react, which is great fun, which is the way radio used to be done. But most of the shows now, it's just one person in there. Same thing with video games. It's just one person in there, and you're busy talking to a character who's not there, and you do three in a row. So you have the choice of the strength of that, or the highs, the lows, attitude. So it's it's a mix and match. So it's not like the way we did Smurfs and Transformers and G.I. Joe and Humanoids. We were all in the room at the same time. Yeah, that made it interesting. But I don't do anime now. You know, I don't really get. I think the last thing I did was Porco something.
Porco Rosso. I think it was a Studio Ghibli movie.
Yeah, I did Porco Rosso. That's the last thing I think I did. I can't remember doing anything. I mean, I've done Tangled and Cars, etc. But that's ancillary voices.
One of the big things I want to ask about, something we talked about before the show, was your work on the first episode of Star Trek The Next Generation where you played Zorn.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things I've always wondered, especially with people working on a show like that in the first season, playing that part, did it in regards to being on that show in comparison to what you've been on before in guest roles, what was that like? How was that similar? How was it different? And did you expect, in your opinion, from what you did on that show, did you expect it to pick up the way that it did?
Oh, I thought it would be a huge hit. Absolutely. It had a huge fan base. I thought it would be a huge hit. I couldn't see anybody saying no, you know, back and, you know, wearing garlic. There's no way. I knew that was going to be a huge hit. I told Brent it was going to be a huge hit. I know Patrick, I think Patrick probably in his heart of hearts felt it was going to be big. I don't know what you know, anybody else felt, you know, whether Jonathan felt it would be a big hit or not, but I can't imagine anybody gets into a show and says, gee, I hope this fails, or I think this is going to fail, I'm looking for something else. I just thought everybody knew that this was going to be a smash hit, and I was glad to be part of it. I read originally for Q, but they decided to give me Grappler's Horn, which was fine, except Q kept coming back and I didn't. So.
Yeah, it is really interesting, though, looking back when that show was made, and like with the original, there was nothing like it, you know, from a special effects perspective, from a makeup perspective, performances. There really was nothing else like that in the mid-80s when that show first came out.
No, when you look back at the original Star Trek, it's sort of childish. It's almost like looking back now at, when I say childish, I mean it's early days of special effects were kind of, you know, kind of rough. We look back then, we go, you know, oh God, isn't this great? But now you look at it now, you go, oh my God, isn't that silly?
Whereas it just looks hokey, basically.
What's that?
It looks hokey compared to the kind of stuff that we do today.
Yeah, and we didn't think it was hokey then. I mean, nobody thought it was hokey then when you looked at it. And I always wanted to be on that show. That was one of the shows I wanted to do. And so I was very fortunate to get the opportunity, and Gene Roddenberry and Corey Allen giving me the opportunity to do that. And then, of course, from that, I wound up doing Deep Space Nine, I think three of them.
So one of the things I wanted to ask, we were talking about your, you know, the mindset of playing a hero and villain earlier. You know, different depending on the game, the film, the different medium, for targeted more towards kids or grown-ups. One of the things I was wanting to ask was, is there a particular character that you've played, either live-action or animation, that you see yourself identifying with, more so than others?
Well, I hope I don't say a serial killer.
Major Blood. Wait, what?
Yes, Major Blood, right. That I played, that I identify with. I'm not sure I've ever played anybody that I identify with. I think I'm pretty much a different guy. Probably.
You don't see yourself identifying with a demigod vampire that sucks souls?
That's close. let's see. No, I don't think so. I don't think I'd let him rip my wings off. I don't think I would have trotted up to him subservient like that. It would really be hard for me to say, yeah, I don't think I identify with any of those characters, to be perfectly honest. I really don't. There's nobody that, looking around here in my trophy room to see who, probably at this point, I probably identify with Lazy Smurf, but that's the closest.
Wait, so you're saying that you're not a corrupt billionaire who completely hates the icon of truth, justice, in the American way?
Oh, listen, I'm all for truth, justice, in the American way. Do you know where it is?
Well, I'm speaking more in regards to the guy on the other side of the coin.
Oh, okay. I'm looking for truth, justice, in the American way. It gets got abrogated somewhere down the line. I think when I did G.I. Joe, we were a little bit more innocent. When I joined the Army, I was a hell of a lot more innocent, I can tell you that.
So, one of the things I wanted to know, this isn't really a question as much as something kind of silly. It is kind of interesting looking back at one of your first roles from the 1950s in Subway in the Sky, where you play a G.I., and then, of course, you end up being the lead star of the show G.I. Joe. And it's just more something silly that I noticed than anything. But I thought it was just kind of a funny coincidence.
Okay, now wait a minute. Let's talk about a coincidence. Subway in the Sky was when?
1959.
Okay, not me. They made a mistake. I kept trying to tell them to take it off. I wasn't doing anything in 59. I didn't stop my career until the 60s.
Stupid IMDb. How dare you lie to the internet? Well, that's never happened before.
Absolutely. They also have my name is Michael Neal, Michael Patrick Bell. I'm surprised they didn't add on Aunt Emily something. I mean, it's just stupid. I keep saying, it's Michael Bell. End of story. There's no Neil. There's no Patrick. It's Michael Bell. And I did not work in the 50s. I didn't do Subway in the Sky. I didn't do something else after that. I didn't do something. There's also one later on that they said I did, but it's another Michael Bell. What's his name? I can't even recall. But anyway, I called about it, and I said, he's a black actor named Michael Bell, and he did a movie with, damn it, I'm trying to think now, Martin Lawrence. He did a film with Martin Lawrence, and they keep telling me it's me, and I said, no, it's not me. I never did that film. Most of those, about 98% or 99% is me, but anything between that one and anything in the 50s is not me. Didn't do it.
It's kind of the reverse of what happened to a friend of mine on YouTube, where he kept putting up this music that he made, and it kept getting pulled, and they told him, you're violating music copyright by stealing this music.
And
he told them, it's my music, I made the music. And then you have your choice, where it's like, we're trying to give you credit for this movie.
Yeah.
You didn't make it. No.
No, I keep telling him, it's not me. I didn't do it, guys. It's not me. You know, don't give me that career then. I'm 38, 48, 58. I would have been 21. I didn't start working at 21. I started working when I was in my 30s. I didn't do anything until I was in my probably early 30s. Those were my first jobs. So by that time, I was, was 38, 48, 58, 68, maybe 68, 1968, something like that, 65, 68, something like that. I can't recall exactly, but I can tell you that twarn't me, won't me at all.
Yeah. One of the questions I wanted to ask, you know, we talked about the characters, some of the characters that you played. What are the, in your opinion, just off the top of your head, what are three of your favorite roles that you've played as a voice actor? Or as an actor, as you put it. As you said, sorry. My brain.
Okay, well, there was a television show I did called, it was a movie that we called Take Your Best Shot. That was really great fun. I played a producer, and I just managed to eat the scenery and got all kinds of cred for it. You know, really good credit for it. I just loved it. It's called Take Your Best Shot. And, That was really a gas. On camera, Three's Company, as the dance teacher. I love doing that, and I also love doing the Maharishi on Three's Company because I got to play something other than your usual bad guy. And of course, in Deep Space Nine, the creature with all the inflatable lungs or something on the side of my neck. That was really super. Getting to get all that makeup done by Mike Westmore. That was a treat. And of course, as I said, Opus and Rugrats for the two characters. For Chaz for Rugrats and Opus for Wish for Wings at Work. I think the two faves.
Now, in regards to working on Star Trek The Next Generation, the first episode, and Star Trek Deep Space Nine, where they were well along into the show and its spinoff. Were there any differences that you noted in regards to production, the process of the show between DS9 and Next Generation?
Yeah, they were both close. I mean, they put all their effort into it. It was beautifully, beautifully done. I mean, a lot of effort, a lot of talent working on it. Special effects, costumes, everybody was just top-notch, people, right from the hair people, makeup people, all top-notch. They didn't stint on anybody. It was just really super. No, it was exactly pretty much the same. In the first, as Grappler Zorn, I did have a moment where they were a little casual when the creature has me in its grips and it lifts me off the ground and I'm suspended in the air, and they do it against a blue screen. To a green screen, and I'm held up by guide wires, and writhing and screaming and crying. And my stunt guy, who I'd hired, said, I'd like a mattress under Michael because I'm about maybe 6 or 7 feet off the ground, flat out, straight out. And they said, well, we won't need it. These wires are really great. We got some great guys here. And he said, yeah, but I want it. And they said, yeah, but it's going to take time. He said, I still want it. And he was dressed in my costume just in case he had to do it for me. I said, no, I want to do it. So they had me lift, and I'm twisting and turning and screaming and crying, and the guide wires broke. The wires holding me broke, and I came crashing down, thankfully, on a mattress. And everybody standing around, and nobody moved, because I could have broken my neck, even though it was a mattress. I was flat. I came down flat. And if my head was tipped back, I could have broken my neck. So I just lay there, and I just didn't do anything. And they said, are you okay? Oh, my God, Mike, are you okay? And I sat up and shook my head, and I said, I don't know. I see a series in my future.
that's awesome. It's like
that improv background, hard at work.
Everybody broke up. They just absolutely were. I said, if I don't, this studio is going to be a parking lot by next week. So they gave me a couple of shows after that. So that was it.
All right. And Shane, did you have another question?
Yeah, well, I guess going back to the favorite characters questions, are there any characters from the video game work that you've done that stick out?
Yeah, actually, as much as I like doing Raziel, because that was, you know, it's just an interesting character, but I think the character I played in Ratchet and Clank, I think what was his name? I can't remember. What was that?
Lawrence, I think was his name.
Lawrence. He was pompous. He was funny. It was a dry character. It was beautifully written. I had great fun doing that. That was really fun. And I did a couple of those. That was fun. That, you know, you look for something that's juicy that you can dig your teeth into, and that was one of those roles. Other than that, a lot of the other roles, of course, are shouting, screaming, crying, dying, which, you know, it's one after another, but that one was the one.
Actually, going back to Legacy of Kain for a second, the Soul Reaver games, that's when I really started to sit up and take notice of voice acting, because to me, that was like video game Shakespeare, some of the lines in that, and some of the delivery.
It was very rich. Amy Hennig wrote a really marvelous series. And of course, Simon and Anna Gunn and Richard Doyle, I mean, and Renee Bergeron. I mean, these are really top class actors. So it was nice to be in that group.
Yeah, if only those vampires had caught on, except for the ones instead of the ones we have today.
I don't mind the vampires today. I love vampire movies. I'm a big even if it's a bad vampire movie, it's got to be really bad for me to leave it. I love sci-fi. And love mysteries, but there's some bad vampire movies. I know that, you know, they're almost like outtakes from Playboy. I mean, it's a really, really terrible. Just a lot of girls, big boobs and bloody teeth. But I enjoy most of the stuff that I see. I don't watch Vampire Diaries though. That doesn't interest me. It's just a lot of pretty people that can, you know, that doesn't interest me. But there's a wonderful vampire movie called Perfect Creatures that is just brilliant. It's a stunning film, and it's a vampire film. Also, Don't Let Them In, I think it's called.
Let the Right One In?
Yeah, Let the Right One In. The original, the one that was done, I think, in Sweden or Denmark or something. It's an absolutely stunning, stunning, dark film.
It's really good. I love the way it's shot.
Yes, but you do have to watch it. You have to see Perfect Creatures. If you get a chance, it's vampires become doctors, literally, they help people, and it's very, very interesting and really frightening because one goes berserk, and they have to find him, and it's a beautifully, beautifully done film, and it's really creepy.
I got to say, two of my favorite vampire movies. You mentioned being a big science fiction fan. One that I think blended the two genres really well was Daybreakers.
Have you seen it? Yeah, yeah. Good. Daybreakers is good. And 38 Days is great. 28 Days. 38 Days. Blah, blah,
blah. 30 Days of Night.
30 Days of Night. Oh, God, that was sensational. That was a sensational film. Sensational. I think it's, you know, a lot of people negate, the critics negate them because of the genre, and I think they're wrong to do that. I like the Underworld
yeah.
film.
I like the first two a lot.
I don't even care. I just say, if it's not good, I don't care. As long as it's not ghastly, as long as it's not terrible, terrible, then I can turn it off. But I really enjoy those. Those are great. And I'm a big fan of hers, too. She can do no wrong.
There was one from the 80s I like in particular. It's like, now it's become Vampire Movie Chat with Michael Bell, but that's awesome, so who cares? There are two that I love from the 80s. One was Near Dark.
Yes!
That movie is so good, and it came out at the same time as Lost Boys, so no one remembers it.
Yeah, but Lost Boys was good. I liked Lost Boys.
I really like Lost Boys, too, but I think this movie underperformed because it came out so close to Lost Boys.
You're probably right. Yeah. No, I enjoyed Near Dark. I thought that was a wonderful film. I mean, listen, I'd always wanted to be in one. Never got to be in one. Always wanted to be in a vampire film and sex and blood and fly away. Always wanted to do that. But never got to do
it. Maybe we should get them in touch with the guys who made Wolf Cop and see if they can make him a vampire.
What's that? Is this an indie film?
Yeah, it's a indie film. It's out of your area, right, Shane?
Yeah, it was produced in Canada, and it's making the rounds. It's actually, I think, getting its first American viewing during Wizard World Chicago. But we actually interviewed the director and the makeup effects artists on Circuit 42, and the movie has been doing incredibly well. It was basically part of this project where one movie was selected to get a budget of $1 million and a limited release in Canada. And since its release, it's actually been at film festivals, and it's been all around the world, and it's been getting incredible reviews.
What's the film called?
It's called Wolf Cop.
Wolf Cop?
Wolf Cop. It's a werewolf cop.
Okay, werewolf cop. Okay, that sounds good. Sounds like something I'd be interested in. Did you ever see Dog Soldiers?
Oh, that movie's awesome.
Yes.
I mean, that's brilliant. That's a brilliant film. Those are people. It's not just, oh, I'm going to turn into a thing or whatever. You know, that's sensational. And that to me is sensational film. And there was another one about the Wolfman. Wolfen was sensational. It's a brilliant film. WLF. Yeah.
Wolfen was really good. It came out around the same time, like we were talking about earlier with, when Near Dark, it came out right around that same period as American Wolf in London and The Howling. And those were, like, the ones that seemed to really pick up a lot of mainstream attention.
And The Howling was good. It's a good film. I mean, those are films. You know, when you do a film that's got big stars in it, for some reason or another, it falls flat on its nose. A wolf stunk. You know, the Jack Nicholson, Anthony Hopkins. Oh, God, it just went from bad to worse. I said, you're overdoing it, guys. God, you know, there's got to be enough rule of thumb for you to get an idea of how that should work. And boy, it doesn't work. Just having a big star doesn't work. You really, really have to have a story.
I think with that movie, they were trying to do too much, and they ended up doing very little by doing that.
Yeah, I mean, it's not my favorite. Listen, you know, what do I know? I'll just tune in. If it's got werewolf in the subject and vampire in the subject or bloodsucker or skinwalkers or whatever the hell it is, I'll watch it.
I like the fact that a lot of the directors, especially known to, like, Neil Marshall with Dog Soldiers, a lot of these directors have been able to pick up these really strong careers. And with Neil Marshall, he's basically just been able to do whatever he wants, which is pretty awesome for someone working in film and television.
He should. He's an enormously talented director. I mean, Dog Soldiers is, I mean, I always recommend it to people. I said, you've got to see this film. It's just such a damn good film. It's so worth it to watch. But what is it about? It's about werewolves. Uh-huh. That's good, Mike. No. It's about people. It's about... Well, anyway, never mind. Not important.
I love how someone described it to me. That got me interested. Because I had been out of the whole werewolf thing for a while. And they said it was like if you took aliens aspects of Evil Dead and then put it in a werewolf movie. And that's what made me really want to watch it, and then I became it. Then I started getting into a lot of indie horror once I saw that movie.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. That's a pretty good analogy. Yeah, that's a good analysis. That's good. Anyway, where are we going with this, guys? We finished up with this thing here. We finished our blog. You got more questions about my life? What's up?
Oh, sorry. We kind of got off talking about movies.
No, I could talk about those movies all day, but I don't have all day. I got to eat eventually. I got to have dinner eventually. So.
All right. Well, you know, with that, big last question. Where can people find you?
Well, I've got a website now. It's just going up slowly, so, you know, everybody be kind. It's michaelbellvoices.com, and I will be at the Sacramento G.I. Joe on September 28th, and we're in Sacramento, G.I. Joe in Sacramento, September 28th. Right now, that's pretty much it. I'm waiting for some more invitations.
All right. Well, it was great to have you on the show. Before we wrap up, I just wanted to say we've had a good amount of guests on the show at this point, and I always try really hard not to geek out. Yeah, I was working really, really hard to do that. This was the one that, I gotta tell you, this was the episode where that was just not going to be a possibility. I realized that about 10 minutes in.
Yeah. You said the same thing to Rob Paulson. Come on. And to Greg Burke. Come on.
But,
what about Maurice LaMarche? That's my geek out guy.
And who is that? Who is it?
Maurice LaMarche.
Oh, Maurice. Yeah, Maurice and I. Maurice is so talented. Oh, boy, is he talented. We were together on a recent Texas. In Texas, you were there, were you not?
I was. That's actually where we met.
So Maurice on my left, D.C. Douglas on my right, Oppenheimer to the right of him, across the way, Berger, and then...
Neil Ross
across the way. And then David Soboloff right next to him. I mean, geez, that's... Boy, I gotta tell you, that was a good group.
And with Peter Cullen there, that was just like the 80s in one room.
Well, did you see when Peter was up there posing all over the place, and I rushed up behind him and gave him a kiss, and he got so thrown. Because after he'd been seeing that, just went right around behind him, gave him a big hug and kiss, and he went, "What? Oh, hey! Oh, Michael Bell!"
That's awesome.
That's fantastic.
Shane, did you want to wrap up the show? Because I'm kind of just cracking up over here, and I really can't right now.
Sure. So this has been Film Circuit Breakdown Presents with our special guest, Michael Bell. Thank you for being here tonight.
It's really my pleasure, and I'm going to do your voice whenever I get the opportunity.
Now you're making fun of me. That's just mean, man.
Yeah, I know, but that's what I do. I'm going to plagiarize your voice.
That's pretty cool.
Now I feel like I sound like a weird mix of Kermit the Frog and Ray Romano. I'm going to be self-conscious about my voice.
You do sound like Ray Romano, but don't be self-conscious. You know, you can always call his agent and say, "Hi, this is Ray, and get my check and give him your address and you know, make some bucks."
Like, Ray, we don't remember you living in Alberta.
My life, I'm going to do that. Thank you.
It's recorded right here on the air, folks.
Oh, God. All right, so this is Shane Fitzgerald for Ian McIntosh telling you to ride the circuit at Circuit 42. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. Be sure to look up michaelbellvoices.com when it's finished. And we'll see you next time.